Hey, you guys. Boy, do I have a surprise for you today. Yes, a very special weekend edition. The feline edition. Yes, it is. I don't normally bring out the cats on my programs. I did get some negative flack from people who have specific ideas of how cats should be taken care of. And I take care of mine the way that I choose. That's how we should all take care of our pets, our companions, the way that we choose. This one here is a special case. I want to introduce them to you because there's special meaning to this. What happens is people dump cats out in the country. I've mentioned this before. And there's also stray cats. In my part of Iowa, this is a big problem. And cats are feral. And what happens is with the farm fields, there's nowhere for them to go except for the farmers who have little islands. I call it the oases, where there's trees, there's a house, the cats show up and they become barn cats. The farmers really don't want them there, but they can't really get rid of them. And what they do is they serve a purpose. They get rid of the rats and the mice, and so they feed themselves. They take care of themselves and stick around the farm, but they're not pets. Well, I started getting cats coming around my property after we moved here, and I couldn't figure out what was going on, and it turns out that they were those cats, and what they were doing was having baby cats. That's what they do. I couldn't catch them, and I couldn't get them to... Uh-oh, here comes Mike. Pass on through, Mike.
Who's got shorts?
Anyway, back to the... you can go that way. Anyway, what happened was is that they had babies. I couldn't stop them because you can try to trap them in traps, but you can't dictate which traps will catch which cat, and it was just a mess. So what I did was I did the very best I could under the situation is I would put some food out in the chicken coop for them. They would eat a little bit of food, but they also got rid of all my rats and mice. Remember, I had rats and mice all over the place? Well, they took care of all of that for me, and that was great. The downside is they had babies. And the upside to those babies is I love kittens. I do. So I let them live here. I take care of them. They are my responsibility. And that's the bottom line is since these cats are having babies and I'm not finding homes for the babies, I take care of them. And remember Clover, I took her in and had her spayed. So I'm doing the very best I can. And that's where people help me out every now and then. So that's really nice. Some people don't like it. Some people do like it. So I wanted to introduce you to this. They don't have their babies here, by the way. They have them out somewhere else, and then when they feel safe, they drag their babies over to the red shed, and that's where they raise them, and eventually the babies get to know me. This one right here is called Sunshine, and I call her Sun-Kissed Sunshine because she's orange. She is the white cat's baby. I found this one in the red shed one morning. There were no kittens around here. Just one morning, I opened up the red shed to get a can of gas for the mower, and there were kittens in there. So that was a surprise. And this one had its eyes sealed shut. You know how they get the sleepies on there? Its eyes were sealed shut. It was real teeny tiny, and it was half dead. And Mama brought it to the red shed, and it was half dead. This one I call Spot. Yep, or Nermal, because it has a little white spot on its back. This one was even smaller, and its eyes were sealed shut. And it was meowing very, very lightly. And it wasn't a regular meow. It was a meow that a cat was dying. This one had its face down on the ground, it face planted. It was laying all sprawled out. And it was meowing very, very faintly. It was at the very edge of life. And there was one more who had passed away. So I found three kittens in there. And I took them into the voodoo garden, these two. And I buried the other one over there by the Honeycrisp tree. That's where all the pets get buried is over by my Honeycrisp tree. These ones, I did the very best I could. I got some antibiotics from the vet, gave them antibiotics. I got some milk replacer, and I started force feeding them milk. And they got stronger, and they got stronger. And eventually, they graduated out of the voodoo garden, and now they're out here. You little butthead. Yep. This one is rough and tumble. This one goes everywhere. It jumps on me, climbs all over me, beats the heck out of me. I am scratched to the dickens. This one is very mellow, totally different personality. Loves to be held up like this, and she reaches up to my face and touches my face. Yeah, she's very sweet. I don't know if it's a he or she, but this one is a whole different personality. She also plays rough with the other kitties, but not with me. Now, after these two were taken care of and weaned out to here, I found two more. This one is a meower. This one I call Bot. Yep, little Bot. And a little Bot was from another cat who brought her babies up to the coop. And this one had a big bump, a big, huge thing on its neck. And I looked at it really close, and there was a hole in that bump that you could almost fit a pencil in. And then something poked its head through the hole. Yeah. And I know from experience, because I've had this happen with a mouse that I was raising when I was 21 years old. It was a bot fly that had laid eggs, and the worm had burrowed into its neck and grew. They get inside the skin, and they live underneath the skin, and it turned into this huge larva that's bigger than a butter bean. Yes, and it lives underneath the skin, eating underneath the skin. This is creeping you out, I know, but I actually had to look at it, and it would stick its little proboscis out, and I tried to get it with the tweezers because this cat wasn't moving. It was just sitting there, and it was half dead. So I tried to get the bot worm out. I couldn't do it. Took it into the vet. The vet removed the bot worm, and I got more antibiotics, and I had to force feed this one. This one went into the voodoo garden, which basically this summer has been the voodoo nursery. And I nursed it back to health, and I'm still trying to wean it. So it'll be weaned very, very soon. And then there's another one over here. This one here is Fuzz. Little Fuzz, really quiet. Little Fuzz is special. Now, genetics are weird. This one did not know how to nurse. Has no idea how to nurse. All it will do is bite on a piece of wood when it wants food. Mama doesn't know what to do with it. And so this cat, when I found it, was lying on its back. And you know how when an animal is in its death throes, it does like this twitch? You know what I'm talking about, if you've ever seen that? This one was doing the death twitch down here. So I rushed that one inside and force-fed it. I didn't think it was going to make it through the day. The next day, it was still alive, and I kept feeding it and feeding it, giving it antibiotics. And it came back to life, too. I brought it back to life. So these are my four special babies right here. There's also another litter in there that another cat brought over. It just keeps going. It keeps going. As they grow up, they tend to disappear. I don't know where they go. I think that they the males go off places. They will not let me near them. None of the adults, like that one over there. If I try to get near her, she'll claw me to death. I can't catch them and get them out of here, because where would they go? If you take them to a shelter, they're never going to find homes. No, they're overwhelmed anyway. And take them in to get spayed, that is another story in itself. Anyway, I wanted to start this off with, these are what you're going to see. If you like it, fine. If you don't like it, that's fine too. I'm not asking you to like it. It's just part of my life. Now that I've done my introductions, I have a program that's called Weekend Edition. That's where you have a question, you want an answer from me, I will answer that question. This is a good one. You're going to like this one. It's not a whole lot of questions, but they're really, really good ones. So I'm going to get started since I spent all this time talking about the cats. If you have any questions about these cats, feel free to post it in the comment section below. But be nice, okay? These are my pets. Well, not my pets. These are my companions. And they're very happy. They're very healthy. I may not be raising them the way that you would choose to, but then again, you may not raise your animals the way I choose to. As friends, we respect each other enough to just let us do our own thing. Okay, well, this one beats the heck out of me. Let's get talking. MC, you're the first one in the lineup. Hi, Ray. Have you ever grown a guava or pomegranate tree? If you have, do you have any tips? I've never grown guava. I've never even seen a guava, as far as I know. But from what I understand about pomegranates, and I've grown pomegranates. I love pomegranates. I've loved them as a kid and even into adulthood. I've grown them inside. I can't grow them outside because the weather year-round doesn't allow that. Inside, I've grown them in pots. What I've learned is you want to make sure that you trim the branches on a pomegranate because they put out big fruit. You've seen the fruit on pomegranates. They tend to be more delicate, especially the dwarf ones. And That cat is peeing into my strawberry bed. Huh. Well, that's different. I've never seen him pee on a screen before. Anyway, trim the branches. Prune them like I do with the apple trees and with everything else. Prune just the stronger branches and form them and get them in a nice shape to where they're going to be strong to hold those fruit. I learned to do that because I grew a dwarf pomegranate inside. And you know what happened? I actually got pomegranate fruit. Yes, I did. I got pomegranate fruit, and it was so huge, it was just pulling the branches down. And that's dangerous for your plant. If you're going to be growing one, you want to grow it for years and years because it's a tree. So make sure you prune off weaker branches in favor of stronger branches. That will be my best advice for you. And good luck with it, by the way. Josie. Hey, Josie. After I called 811, I didn't know what 811 was when I read this question. Apparently, it's a before you dig line, like when you're digging in the yard, you call them up and they tell you where the lines are and stuff. Anyway, I think that's what she meant. After I called 811, before I dug in my yard, I realized that I planted my very productive 6-year-old peach tree over the main gas line. Oh, that sucks. The man told me that the line is 3 or 4 feet deep underground. Should I cut the tree or leave it alone? If I cut the tree down, I know I shouldn't pull the roots up because they may be tangled in with the pipes, right? Two questions that I have a feeling you know the answer to. The man I talked to doesn't seem to give me the answer I'm comfortable with. Thanks, Ray. Well, let me tell you, Josie, if you just planted your tree, don't worry about the roots being tangled up. What you do is you cut around the tree a couple feet out, or about a foot to 2 feet. I recommend 2 feet out from the trunk. Cut down about a foot to a foot and a half. 2 feet would be great, but a foot and a half is fine. And then dig in and then lift up the tree. If you cut a couple roots, don't worry about it. The tree will have enough roots to survive and even thrive. Cut that out, have somebody help you, put it onto a tarp, move it to another area, dig a hole that's going to be at least a half a foot wider and a half a foot deeper. Put some compost in that hole, plant the whole root ball with that dirt in there, and then put dirt around it and fill it in, and then put some mulch over it, water it well, and your tree is going to be just fine. So don't worry about that at all. I suggest moving the tree. Give that tree a chance because I don't believe that the roots are tangled up in the gas line. And even if they are, you're not going to dig down to the gas line and you're going to cut a few of the lower roots off. It's not going to hurt your tree at all. Good luck with your peach tree, by the way. Next one, Lee. Hey, Lee. Hi, Ray. I have 2 8-foot patio doors which face south. Oh, you lucky dog. I've grown plants inside. I always wished that I had patio doors on my south. I only had them on the north. I would love to grow tomatoes, lettuce, and maybe a cucumber plant through the winter. I get full sun, but think I may need to supplement the light. How many hours would I need to keep the light on? I get approximately 9 hours of sun. Well, if you get 9 hours of sun, I don't think you're going to need extra light. Put those plants right by that window during the winter time, and I think you're going to be just fine. Indoors, you're never going to get huge bumper crops, but you will get good plants. You will get a fruit now and then, like a couple small cucumbers here and there, some tomatoes, but make sure you plant them in rich, well-drained soil and prune them like with a cucumber plant. Don't let tons of vines grow everywhere because it's not going to be able to produce a lot of fruit in that limited soil space, in that limited amount of light. Pick and choose your vines. Have like maybe 3 strong vines growing off that cucumber plant. It's going to do you better. Same thing with the tomato plant. Prune your tomato plant. Get one that's going to either produce cherry tomatoes, or if you're going to try for beefsteaks, you're going to be bold, but only have like 1 or 2 branches growing. That way you don't have this monster plant trying to supplement all over the place and try keeping the fruit alive. You're just a happy little camper, aren't you? Yes, you are. Anyway, let's go on to Bayful Wolf. Bayful Wolf. Hey, Bayful Wolf. Hi, Ray. I'm eagerly awaiting the mule team and Praxis chair seats. Oh, I feel so bad about that. On last week's, the last program, I mentioned those. I'm really sorry about that. Anyway, they go on. I have a question. How do you determine which seeds to save from the varieties you grow? I answered that. I didn't mean to answer that, but I did answer that on the last program. Is that I only choose the best looking fruit because genetics are everything. So with the fruit, I pick the biggest, most well-shaped, sweetest fruit, and I save the seeds from that. That way, if there's any chance of them passing on genetics, they're passing on the genetics from the best of the best, and then I grow that. That's how I've genetically grown my plants, is saving the best of the best, the seeds from those, and that's how I pass on the genetics. But unfortunately, we have a drought and the plants didn't do well this year. But I will save seeds from the best fruit of those plants and plant that next year, and I'm hopefully going to have a better crop, then I'll be able to offer seeds. So stay tuned for those. Shane, hey Shane, I plant a lot of basil because, oh, I like the smell of basil. I don't use a lot, but I love the smell of it. You got that look like you're about ready to attack me. I don't like that look. Can't you just love me? Can't cats just love you? Do they always have to attack you like you're a toy? Anyway, I plant a lot of basil because I love drying it and making pesto. I've never had any problems before, but this year, I've had to pull two of my plants out of six because the leaves turned black underneath and then the whole thing turned yellowish and finally brown. I'm not sure if it's mold or if it's just too hot. I'm in North Carolina and it's really humid as well, but it's spreading to the remaining four plants, which are on a different bed, and pretty sure I'm going to have to pull them as well. Is there anything I can do to prevent this next time I plant? I also have some purple Cherokee tomatoes, but they're cracking on top where the tomato connects to the vine and it's turning brown. Is there a remedy for that? You are just having hot summer issues, and that's what that is. Hot summer doesn't necessarily mean the heat is hurting your plant, but it could mean that the watering issues are getting a little bit uneven, or you're getting a fungus. That black with the basil, to me, it sounds like a fungus. I don't see a picture of it, so I don't know. I'm going to take a guess that it's a fungus because it's spreading to all your different beds. If it was just a watering issue, one bed would have a problem, the other one may survive. But since it's going to all your plants, my guess is it's a fungus issue, and you can spray for fungus. Find a fungicide, spray your plants. The problem with that is basil leaves are the leaves are what you save, not the there's no fruit that you save. So if you're spraying the leaves with a fungicide, I don't know, because then you're going to be eating those leaves. The best I could say is to hope for next year. This year may be a wash, but next year you'll probably have better luck. That's my guess. Same thing with the tomatoes. You're having an issue this year because of the heat, and also sometimes the watering issue goes back and forth. That's why they're cracking. And what happens is your plants will get a lot of water, then no water. A lot of water, then no water. And what happens is that when they get a lot of water, they shove it into the fruit really fast. And the tomato grows faster than the skin can expand, and it cracks. Then the cracks seal. Then it grows again, and it cracks some more, and it seals. And that area tends to turn a brownish color. That's not bad. I mean, you can eat it. It's not bad. That's just how the tomato grows. Some varieties have a tougher skin that does not expand as easily. I don't know anything about that variety other than they're delicious. But I grew it once, and they did crack. Mine did crack as well. So my guess is it's just uneven watering. If you want to, mulch around your plants, and that keeps the soil evenly moist, and it slows down on the cracking. Next one is from Rebecca. Hey, Rebecca. Hey, Ray. Do you do anything special to help your chickens beat the heat through the summer? I live in Oklahoma, and the heat and humidity is horrible on my chickens. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. If you're growing chickens, if you're raising chickens, one thing you have to do if you want to have healthy, happy chickens or live chickens is you got to have a place of shade. Doesn't have to be air conditioned or fanned or anything like that. Chickens are well capable of taking care of themselves as long as they have the basics. Food, water, shade. And that's what they need. You're not graceful at all. What they need is shade. And what they'll do is they'll shed some of their flower. they'll shed their flowers. No, they shed some of their feathers. And they molt during the summer, and they'll also stop laying sometimes in order to conserve energy, because that's a lot of energy to produce the eggs. And what they want to do is they want to keep themselves cool. They'll divest themselves of laying eggs. They'll divest themselves of some of their feathers in order to stay cooler. You'll also see them holding their wings out like that. That allows air to go underneath their wings, and it releases some of the heat. They'll pant a lot. Make sure they have plenty of water. And as long as they have shade, they'll be fine. Any amount. See, chickens are jungle fowl. That's where they originally came from jungles. So they're used to heat, but they need the shade of the jungle. So if you don't have trees around, put some kind of an overhang like mine. They go inside the coop. It's opened, a door on one side, a door on the other. Air goes through there, and it keeps them cooler. I'm going to beat your butt. Yes, I am. The air will go through there, and it helps keep them cool during the heat of the day. Next one, Hugh. Hello, Ray. I bought some seed off your little... thank you for buying from Little Shop of Seeds. They're lovely, all of them. They grow, except lavender. You know, I've had this before. I try to refrigerate them in Ziploc bags and wet towels, and directly, I plant them directly into soil. Both ways don't work. How do I get them to germinate? Well, lavender is a tricky little booger. The lavender requires light in order to germinate. See, I don't give any kind of instructions, germinating instructions, or anything like that on the website. I just sell the seeds. And I choose to do it that way. That way I can keep it inexpensive. I don't have to put directions on anything. You can look up the directions if you want. I just sell the seeds, and that's how I do it. So inexpensive. But I will give you advice on lavender and anybody else who's tried to grow lavender and didn't have luck. Because somebody emailed me and they said, something's wrong with your seed. It's not growing. I said, no, there's nothing wrong with the seed. There's something wrong with how you're growing it. When you plant lavender, like say if you're going to plant it in a pot, you take a good well-drained soil. It doesn't have to be that rich because lavender doesn't really like rich soil. It likes well-drained, sandy type of soil. So make sure you get yourself like a cactus mix. Mix it with a little bit of potting soil. Put it in a pot, take your seeds, sprinkle them on top, tap them down. Do not, I repeat, do not bury those seeds. They need to be in contact with the soil, but they also need sunlight in order to germinate. Aha! Water them, let them dry out. Water them, let them dry out. That's what they need in order to germinate. If you don't do that, if you cover them up or put them in a moist paper towel, they're not going to germinate. The moist paper towel is too much moisture. They're more of a desertish, prairie type of plant, so they require the wet, dry cycle, mostly dry to germinate. Give it a shot. I think you're going to enjoy that. Okay, let me just deal out advice. Rick, hey Rick. Oh, I got to cycle my camera. Cycle my camera before it turns off. Be right back. You guys, wait right here. Holy cow! What's wrong with you? What's in your food? You little weirdo. Go beat up somebody else. Go beat up mama. There, yeah. Beat her up. He is tough. I throw him all over the place and he comes running back. I think it's a he. I got a feeling it's a he or a very, very angry female. Okay, back to our questions. Rick. Hey, Rick. Hey, Ray. A couple of weeks ago, I asked you about sowing clover. I sowed a lot, but they grow very tall, 2 to 3 feet tall. Is there a way to keep the clover lower to the ground like you see in lawns? Maybe I sowed it too much in the in the same place. Well, wow, the sun came out. Look at it go. It's bright. Well, I'll continue. With clover, it's not so much a matter of how you grow it, it's a matter of what you grow. I suggest Dutch white clover. That's the kind that grows around my yard, Dutch white clover, and they tend to grow lower than the purple stuff. Purple stuff gets huge and tall, but the Dutch white, it grows really short, and it stays short, and it takes a mowing really well. I mow it down when it goes to flower, and it throws the flowers all over. They go to seed. They make more of it. Dutch white. Try that out. I think that'll work well for you. Ooh, and I got a surprise coming up on Little Shop of Seeds. There is a clover. I think it's called crimson. Crimson. I'll have to look it up. But crimson clover is a weird one. It gets tall, but it has these tall red flowers. You may have heard of this, folks, and people use this in tea. They're edible flowers. You eat them on salads. You put them in tea. They're delicious. It's a special kind of clover that I got for Little Shop of Seeds. I'm going to add those seeds to it this autumn. I got a few of them, like radicchio, clover, arugula, things like that to add to the website. It's going to be cool. Check in on it every now and then. I'll let you know when it's available. I've just been way too busy to deal with it right now, but I do have the seeds. I will be adding them this fall. Next one, last page of questions. And they get interesting from here. Yes, they do. Lori. Hey, Lori. Hi, Ray. First timer with a question. I have some of my plants outdoors enjoying the summer weather. When I want to bring them indoors, my plants indoors this fall, what can I do to make sure there are no yuckies, I love the word yuckies, in the soil and not bring it indoors? Oh, gosh. I had a couple programs on that, how to bring your plants safely indoors. This is what I do if they're in pots. What I do is I use neem, and you can use peroxide. What you want to do is you want to take something and disinfect the soil because they've been outside all summer. What they do is they have insects in that soil that you do not want coming inside, because outside we have nature's balance. We have predators, we have prey. Everything has something that feeds off of it. So if you have spider mites on your plants outside, you have something that's eating those spider mites. If you have aphids, you got something that's eating the aphids. You got the balance. You bring them inside, you broke that balance because you may not have the predators to take care of those plants, of those things that are eating your plants. So what you want to do, you want to disinfect before you bring it inside. What I do is one of two things. You can take peroxide and mix peroxide of, what is it? One part peroxide, three parts water, mix it up, and take your plant and drench it edge to edge all over on the soil until it runs out the bottom. Wait until your plant needs water. Wait until it dries out a bit. Do that until it drains all the way through. Peroxide will dissolve soft insect bodies that are in your soil. Another way is to use what's called neem, N-E-E-M. You mix it up as directed, you do a soil drench, the same way you did the peroxide, and that will leave a residual that any insect in there will eat and die. Okay, so that'll kill them. Then on your plant, what you want to use, is you want to use pyrethrin. And you mix that up, mist your plant, top to bottom, up and down, do that. The same day you do the neem treatment, drain it all out. Bring it inside right away. Do not wait 5 minutes. Do not wait until it all dries out. Bring them inside. Because once the pyrethrin dries off, it leaves no residual. Insects can get right back on your plants. And that should take care of it. Also, when you bring them inside, expect them to go through a little bit of a shock period where they lose some leaves and start looking like crap. That's the adjustment period from being outside where it's really nice to inside where it's not quite so nice. They will drop leaves. They will look like crap for a while. Eventually, they get their mind right. They'll start putting out new leaves for indoors. Good luck with your plants. Okay. Dolores. Hey, Dolores. Ray, how do you... Hi. Why are you chewing on my elbow? Is it because you love me? Oh. This one comes up and nibbles on me and licks on me, and this one just rips me to shreds. I have so many scratches on me from that little Tasmanian devil. Ugh. Okay, anyway. Ray, how do you deal with squirrels in your garden? This is my way of dealing with squirrels. I don't have any here because I think the cats ate them all. That's one of the things, nice thing about having all these cats is people think, wow, you got so many cats, there's just too many cats. Well, you know, I used to have rats and mice and squirrels and chipmunks tearing apart my garden and infesting my coop. I don't have any anymore. So it's a balance. Either I have too many cats or I have too many rats. I'd rather have too many cats. But with squirrels, when I lived in Minnesota, I had this problem when I lived in Delft. I lived in town for a little while. And I had neighbors and I had a smaller piece of property. I had squirrels all over the place. And they will. They'll dig up bulbs. They'll eat your garden. What I did was the exact opposite of what people would think. I fed them. I did. What I did was, on the exact opposite side of my yard, I put a bowl. I bought a huge 50-pound bag of corn from the feed store. And I would put a bowl of corn over there. And the you cannot nurse off of me. That's just, no, I don't do that. What they did was they went over there and ate the corn. And they ate all the corn. I put out more corn. They got fat. They got fat, they got lazy, they filled up with corn because it was easy to get. And of course my garden is fenced in and I'm trying to keep them out of my garden. They took the easy route and they went on to the opposite side of my yard and ate the corn and left my garden alone. That's how I dealt with them. I diverted them out of my garden. So give that a shot if you want. I know it sounds ridiculous, feed them on the opposite side of your yard because it's practically impossible to squirrel-proof a garden. They can get in the smallest of cracks, and you have to fence your garden top to bottom, up and down. They will get in there one way or the other. That's the only way I have ever found to get rid of squirrels. If anybody else has any ideas, feel free to post it in the comment section below. I'm sure she'd like to hear that, but that's how I did it. Okay, the last two questions. These ones. I want you to, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna read them both. And then I'm going to answer them both at the same time, okay? I think this is something that needs to be answered. And like I said, if you have a question, I will answer your question to the very best of my ability. And the last week in addition, somebody asked me about something, and it was a touchy subject. I answered it. But then again, if they didn't like the answer, maybe they shouldn't have tuned in. And some people didn't like the answer, but that's just how it was. I answered with my opinion. So I'm not giving you facts, I'm just giving you opinion. Keep that in mind when I read these next two questions, okay? And also keep an open mind, if you would. I would really appreciate that. All right, Doodah Girl and Sandra. Both of your questions are here. Doodah Girl says, I loved your answer to the last question about the statues. That's the one I'm talking about. You are one wise old man. Now that I don't know, okay? Wisdom for me is basically, you made a lot of mistakes and hopefully you learn from those mistakes. That's what my wisdom is. I've screwed up a lot in my life, more than most people. So I have the wisdom of living through that. So I don't know, I don't know what the value of wisdom is other than I lived through it. But I'll take that as a compliment. Thank you. Now I'm curious about your opinion on masks. You know, the masks that we wear nowadays. And Sandra, she says, Ray, what is your thinking about Corona 19? Is crazy or what? Okay, yeah. Well, I'm going to go ahead and take that on, head on, because that's what I do. I answer your questions, and I'm going to give you honesty. This is what I'm going to give you, my opinion and honesty. And some common sense, okay? I'm not gonna take a stance on one side or the other. I'm just gonna give you my opinion, okay? Because this is a very touchy subject in the world, but more importantly, in the United States right now. This is crazy stuff. We have a killer, and in all seriousness, I joke a lot, but we do. We have an invader on the planet right now, and it's silent. It's deadly. It doesn't care who you are. It doesn't care where you are. It doesn't care how much money you have. It doesn't care that you have things to do. And to steal a quote that I saw in a movie one time that really makes sense right now from decades ago, it can't be bargained with. It can't be reasoned with. It doesn't feel pity. It doesn't feel remorse. And it absolutely will not stop until you're dead. And that's what this is. This is something that's crazy. This is a once-in-a-lifetime thing that's happening to us, and it will go down in the history books. This is a historic occasion, and not a good one at that. Coronavirus is a deadly killer. It is. And the insidious thing about it is it can infect a person, and you may not have symptoms. You may not even know you have it. And you can spread it so easily just by opening your mouth, just by doing the most basic of human things is breathing. And you can spread it to somebody, and you can spread it to everybody. That's the crazy thing about it. So this is something that I think we need to take serious, because it's going everywhere and people are dying from this. People that shouldn't have to die from this. My opinion on this is I wear a mask when I go out in public. I wear a mask. I don't like it. I don't like the mask. I don't want to wear a mask. I feel uncomfortable wearing the mask. It does not enhance my enjoyment of my life at all. But one thing that it will do is it's not a cure, okay? Let's get this straight. Masks do not stop this virus all the way. Social distancing does not stop this virus all the way. Staying at home does not stop this virus all the way. All three of these things that are recommended for us by science are not perfect. They don't claim to be perfect, and they don't claim to be an end-all cure for this problem that we're having. What it is it's the best we have at the moment, and we're working on it as best as we can. In an imperfect situation, we have imperfect solutions. All three of these things are the best that we can do right now at this time. And for me to wear a mask, it isn't really so much keeping me from getting this virus. It's keeping anybody I come in contact from getting it if I happen to have it. And no, the mask doesn't stop the virus itself. The virus is way too small. I know this. But what it does is it slows down and stops the moisture droplets that can carry the virus. So it slows it down and keeps it. It deflects my breath around me instead of going out towards you. Your mask does the same for me. So my mask isn't protecting me. I wear a mask to protect you. You wear a mask, hopefully, to protect me and to protect other people like me. So My opinion is, I would hope that people will do the best that they can. I know it's not comfortable. I know you don't want to do it. But the thing is that that's what I believe human beings would do for their fellow human beings. And I find it fascinating and horrifying all at once that some people, and I don't want to belittle you, I just find it sad and disconcerting that some people would not do the minimum they could do to potentially not kill another human being. It's the least we can do to do the most that we can do right now to help people as much as possible. And for instance, when I go out, and I don't go out that often anymore. I didn't go out before. I was a bit of a hermit. Now I'm super hermit because I have, and this is something I don't talk about, I have medical conditions that cause my immune system to be almost non-existent. So I don't have the tools to fight this disease. And I also have damaged lungs. I've had pneumonia 3 times in my life, double pneumonia, and it almost killed me all 3 times. I smoked for 30 years, my fault. But that smoking gave me emphysema. I stopped smoking. I've done the best that I can to mitigate my damage to my health. My lungs are my weak spot. Sadly, that is exactly what coronavirus does, is it goes right into your lungs and attacks your lungs. If I were to get this, if I were to contract this, there's a 100% chance I will die. No amount of respirator, no amount of antibiotics, no amount of care is going to save my life. I will die from this, 100% chance. So I wear a mask to try to keep myself, if I were to get it, from giving it to you. And when I go out and I see people not wearing a mask, because it's their right to not wear a mask or they don't believe in masks, I'm thinking, what if you have it and you don't know it, and that comes out of your lungs and it gets to me and I catch it? You just killed me. And you could have not killed me. And I would have appreciated if you wouldn't kill me. It's the very least that I would hope for from anybody in this world. So I'm doing what I can, and it would be nice if people would take it to heart. I know you look ridiculous in a mask. I know it's uncomfortable. I know it's inconvenient. You may not believe in them, but at the very least, do the very least you can to not kill people. So many people could have not died had we done this. And so yes, I believe in wearing masks, and I would hope that people would do this. This is something that I don't know if it's going to last, if it's going to be here forever. It may be around. It may be a new thing for us. But people are dying. People are dying all across our country and all across the world. And I don't know what the answer is. I'm no genius. I'm no scientist. Everybody thinks they have the answer. They have the solution. They have a variety of cures and ways to deal with this. But the fact is that those people are dying. People that follow another path are dying. Everybody is dropping dead, and it's not supposed to be like this. We're supposed to be better than this, to where if something comes along, we pull together as a community, as a human race, to try to help one another. It's, you know, I can't believe that people don't want to help other people. It doesn't cost you anything. All it is to wear this silly piece of cloth on your face, and you never know. You may not save somebody, but you may save somebody's life. And if I live through this, it's because I was lucky, for one thing, and possibly because one person wore a mask that was infected and I didn't get infected. That's my opinion, folks. You may like it, you may not like it. That's your prerogative. And it's also your prerogative to do what you think is best for helping other people in this situation that we're in. So I hope that you make the decision to err on the side of caution, and maybe think hard on this. It's not a conservative thing, a liberal thing, Republican, Democrat. I don't fall into any of those categories. I'm not conservative. I'm not liberal. I'm not Democrat. I'm not Republican, Independent. I have no political leanings whatsoever. The only leanings I have is to be kind to other people and to do whatever you can whenever you can to help your fellow human being. And I would hope that you would do this as well. So it's your choice. It's your choice, just as what I do is my choice. Thanks for joining me for today's program. I hope to see you next time. Cross our fingers. Take care of yourself. Have a good day.